The following is a class on the Bhagavad Gita as it is, 4th chapter, text number 11 through 18, given by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, recorded on January 8, 1969, in Los Angeles.
Everyone is searching after Krishna in a different aspect of His manifestation. Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, is partially realized in the impersonal Brahma-jyoti or shining effulgence. Krishna is also partially realized as the all-pervading supernova dwelling within everything, even in the particles of matter.
It's not extend, right?
But Krishna is only fully realized by His pure devotees. Therefore, Krishna is the object of everyone's realization. And as such, anyone and everyone is satisfied according to one's desire for happiness. One devotee may want Krishna as the Supreme Master, another as his personal friend, another as his son, and still another as his lover. Krishna rewards equally all the devotees in their different intensities of love for Him. In the material world, the same reciprocations of feelings are there, and they are equally exchanged by the Lord to the different types of worshippers. The pure devotee, both here and in the transcendental abode, associate with Him in person and are able to render personal service to the Lord, and thus derive transcendental bliss in His loving service. As for those who are impersonalists and who want to commit spiritual suicide by annihilating the individual existence of the living entity, Krishna helps them also by absorbing them into His devotion. Such impersonalists do not agree to accept the eternal physical personality of Godhead, and consequently they cannot relish the bliss of transcendental personal service to the Lord,
yes,
and may extinguish their individuality.
God realization, there are three aspects. Brahmeti, Paramatmeti, Bhagavaniti, Sardate. The Absolute Truth is realized in three aspects. Brahman, Paramatman and Bhagavan. Brahma, the impersonal conception of the Absolute Truth, that is called Brahma. And Paramatma is localized aspect of the Absolute Truth. And Bhagavan is the ultimate realization, personality of God. The same example as I have given several times in these classes, that a light, sunlight, is realized first of all as sunshine. Then if you can go further, the sun planet, up to the sun planet, that is localized aspect. And if you enter into the sun planet, then you will find the sun god is there. His person. The same example is in the case of Absolute Truth. The impersonal realization is not ultimate realization. Ultimate realization is the Supreme Personality of God. This is supported in Brahma Samhita. Yasya prabha prabhavatu jagadanda koti. By expansion of Lord's personal effulgence, the Brahma realization is there. So the original verse says that all of them as they surrender unto me, I reward accordingly. Every one follows my path in all respects. This means that everyone is searching after their absolute truth. Some of them are satisfied with impersonal features, the philosophers, gyanis. Because they want to understand the absolute truth by dint of their imperfect knowledge. Because we are in this condition state, our senses are imperfect. Therefore, whatever knowledge we gather, that is imperfect, that is not perfect. So, if I endeavor to understand what is absolute truth, my means of understanding are the senses, but the senses are imperfect. Therefore, whatever knowledge I gather by exertion of the senses, that is imperfect, that is not perfect. Persons who are trying to understand the absolute truth by exercising their imperfect knowledge, they reach up to the impersonal conception. And persons who are still farther advanced, just like yogis, they are trying to meditate upon the localized aspect of the absolute truth, the Paramatma, the Super Soul. They're little farther advanced. But persons who have realized the Supreme Personality of Godhead, they are supposed to be the ultimate realizer. So God is realized by all of them, but not on the same level. Another example, just like from a very distant place, you see one hill, you will find just like it is a cloud. If you go farther, near, you will see it is something green. And if you reach the mountain, then you will see there are so many trees, so many animals, houses and living beings. The same example can be given here. One who is observing the absolute truth from a very distant place, their conception is impersonal. One who is farther advanced, their conception is localized. God is situated in everyone's heart, that is localized. Therefore Krishna says that my way is followed by everyone. The impersonalists, they are also aiming to the same goal. And the yogis are the localized realizers. They are also aiming the same goal. But the devotees, they have reached the same goal. That is the difference. The impersonalists or the yogis, they could not reach the final goal. But the devotees, they have reached the final goal. Therefore, you find in the Bhagavad Gita, the Lord says, Bahunam janmanamante jnanamān māṁ prapadyat. After many, many births of transcendental realization, one surrenders unto me, accepting Vāsudeva sarvamiti. Vāsudeva Krishna is everything. So Mahātmā sudullava. That sort of Mahātmā, great soul, is very rare. So,
to accept the eternal blissful personality of Godhead, and consequently they cannot relish the bliss of transcendental personal service to the Lord, having extinguished their individuality. Some of them, who are not situated even in the impersonal existence, return to the material field to exhibit their dormant desires for activities. They are not admitted into the spiritual planet, but they again are given a chance to act on the material planet. For those who are fruitive workers, the Lord awards desired results of their prescribed as the yajna bar. And those who are yogis seeking mystic power are awarded such power. In other words, everyone is dependent for success upon his mercy alone, at all times spiritual processes are of different degrees exist on the same path. Unless therefore one comes to the highest perfection of Krishna consciousness, all attempts remain imperfect, as is stated in the Srimad Bhagavatam. Whether one is without desire, the condition of the devotees, or is desirous of all fruits of that result, or is after liberation, one should with all efforts try to worship the Supreme Personality of Godhead for complete perfection, culminating in Krishna consciousness.
Yes, this verse refers to the statement of Srimad Bhagavatam, wherein it is stated that akama sarvakama va moksha kama udaradhi tibrena bhakti yogena jajeta paramam purus. The idea is that there are three classes of men. One class of men, they are simply desiring. Material comforts, desire. They want nice house, nice wife, nice comfortable life, everything nice for the comfort of this body. They are called sarvakama. Sarvakama means their desire has no end. Just like in the modern materialistic world, they are trying to improve material comforts, but they do not know where does it end. One after another. Therefore, they are called sarvakama, unlimitedly desiring. There is no end of desire. Such persons, akama, and akama means one who has no desire. Just like those who are devotees, Krishna conscious, they have no desire. They don't like any material comforts, any material improvements. They want simply Krishna. Akama, sarvakama ma, and moksha kama. Moksha kama means one who is disgusted with this material desires and aspires after something void, impersonal, or freedom from all these desires. Moksha kama. So Bhagavad says that either you are a person desiring unlimitedly, or you have become freed from all desire, or you are desiring liberation from this material conditional life. You please try to become Krishna conscious. Your desires, whatever desires you may have, that will be fulfilled. That will be full. This is referred akama sarvakama. So whatever desires you may have, if you become Krishna conscious, then your that desire will be fulfilled. Wow.
Quickly, of course, men get results from fruitive work in this world. 13. According to the three modes of material nature and the work ascribed to them, the corresponding four divisions of human society were created by me. And although I am the creator of this system, you should know that I am yet the non-doer, being unchanged. Report. The Lord is the creator of everything. Everything is born of Him, everything is sustained by Him, and everything after annihilation rests in Him. He is therefore the creator of the four divisions of the soul.
There are three conditions. Just like I have got this body, you have got your body. This body is developed, created. You know, in the mother's womb, the first body was just like a pea when it was first created. These descriptions are there in the Srimad Bhagavatam. After sex life of the man and woman, there are two kinds of secretions. They mix up, emulsify, and they form into pea-like shape. In that pea-like shape, the living entity which is atomic takes shelter. And because the living entity takes shelter in that pea-like form, it develops. Just like you see the child born, he is also developing. So this is the nature. Everything is born and it develops, it stays and it gives byproduct, then it dwindles and then vanishes. These are the stages, different 6 stages. So after vanquishing, after annihilation, where does it stay? It stays in God. Then again takes birth. The whole material cosmic manifestation, bhutya bhutya puliyate, the creation is coming into existence. It stays for some time. It develops, gives some byproduct, then dwindles, then vanishes. And after vanishing, it stays in the same principle, the absolute truth. That is being explained. Go on.
Beginning with the intelligence class of men, technically called the Brahmins, due to their being situated in the mode of living. Next is the administrative class, technically called the Kshatriyas, due to their being situated in the mode of passions. The mercantile men, called the Vaishyas, are situated in the mixed modes of passion and ignorance. And the Sudras, or the neighbor class, are situated in the ignorant mode of material nature. In spite of his creating the 4 divisions of human society, Lord Krishna does not belong to any of these divisions, because he is not one of the conditioned souls, a section of whom formed human society. Human society is the same as animal society, but to elevate men from the animal status, the above-mentioned divisions are created by the Lord for the systematic development of Krishna consciousness. The tendency of a particular man towards work is determined by the mode of material nature which he has acquired. Such symptoms of life according to different modes of material nature are described in the 18th chapter of this book. A person in Krishna consciousness, however, is above even the Brahmin, because a Brahmin by quality is supposed to know about Brahma, the Supreme Absolute Truth. Most of them approach the impersonal Brahman manifestation of Lord Krishna, but only a man who transcends the limited knowledge of a Brahmin and reaches the knowledge of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Sri Krishna, becomes a person in Krishna consciousness, or in other words, a Vaishnava. Krishna consciousness includes knowledge of all different planetary expansions of Krishna, namely Brahma, Nishringa, Balama, etc. As Krishna is transcendental to the system of the 4 divisions of human society, a person in Krishna consciousness is also transcendental to the mundane divisions of human society, whether we consider the divisions of community, nation, or
human. Yes, Krishna has many incarnations. Sometimes he appears in the species of fish. Keshavadhita meena sarira jaya jagadisa hare. That does not mean that he belongs to the fish community. Similarly, when Krishna appeared as the son of Vasudev belonged to the Kshatriyas. That does not mean that he belonged to the Kshatriya community. Then again, he was transferred to Vrindavan to become the foster son of Nanda Maharaj. And Nanda Maharaj was a Vaishya, mercantile community man. So that does not mean that Krishna belongs to the Vaishya community. He does not belong to any community. You should not take Krishna that because he appeared in India, therefore he is Indian or Indian God. That is a mistake. Krishna is for everyone. Do not consider that Krishna belongs to the Hindu community or Krishna belongs to the India or anyway, Kshatriya. No, he does not belong to any material designation. He is above. And you'll find in the Bhagavad Gita, 14th chapter, he claims, Sarvajoni Shukaunte or Sambhavanti Murtaj. There are 8,400,000 of forms of living entities, including human beings. And Krishna says, Ahagabija Padapita, I am their seed-giving father. So he claims to be father, not only of the human society, but of the animal society, beast society, bird society, insect society, aquatic society, plant society, tree society, all living entities. God cannot belong to any particular community or class. That is misconception. God must belong to everyone. So, when we speak of Krishna consciousness, do not take it as a sectarian view. Try to understand the philosophy. He belongs to every living entity. He is the supreme living entity. Nitya nityanam chetana chetananam. That is the Vedic verse. He is the leader of all living entities. By our different results of our work, we have assumed different dresses. But as living entities, we are part and parcel of the Supreme Lord. Try to understand Krishna consciousness in that way. So,
there is no work that affects me, nor do I aspire for the fruits of action. One who understands this truth about me does not become entangled in the fruits of reactions of work.
Because he does not belong to any community or anything of this material world, he has nothing to do. We work. Why we work? Because he wants some material profit. He hasn't got to take any profit, so why should he work? He says, therefore, that there is no work that affects me. But still he comes. Why? That is explained in the beginning. Jada jada hi dhanma saklani bhavati. When there is discrepancies in the matter of religiosity, I come down to make things ordered, to set things in right order. That is his work. Go on.
All the liberated souls in ancient times acted with this understanding and so attained liberation. Therefore, as did the ancients, you should perform your duty in this divine consciousness. Verse 4. There are two classes of men. Some of them are full of polluted material things within their hearts, and some of them are materialist priests. Krishna consciousness is equally beneficial for both of these persons. Those who are full of dirty things can take to the line of Krishna consciousness for a gradual cleansing process, following the regulative principles of devotional service. Those who are already cleansed of the impurities may continue to act in the same Krishna consciousness, so that others may follow their exemplary activity and thereby be benefited. Foolish persons or neophytes in Krishna consciousness often want to retire from activity without having knowledge of Krishna consciousness. Arjuna's desire to retire from activities on the battlefield was not approved by the Lord. One need only know how to act. To retire from activities and to sit aloof, making a show of Krishna consciousness, is less important than actually engaging in the field of activity for the sake of Krishna.
Krishna consciousness does not mean laziness. We do not indulge, just like Arjuna. This Bhagavad Gita was taught to Arjuna. He wanted to retire. Say, Krishna, why you are engaging me in this battlefield? Let me retire. So Krishna did not allow him to retire, to understand his position. That is required. Retirement, how you can retire? You cannot retire. So long you have got this body, you have to work. If you do not work, you have to beg. If you do not beg, then you have to steal, or you have to borrow. How you can retire? There is no question of retire. Retire means to retire from all foolish activities and engage yourself in real activities. Retire is the negative side. But unless you have got positive side, you cannot retire. You'll have come back again. There are so many yogis and jnanis. They say that this world is false. Let me retire from it. But after some time, he again falls down, again to the sense gratification, this material world. So what is retirement? Retirement is not required, but what is required, that purify your activities. Not to stop your activities, but to purify you. Just like when you are diseased. It is not required that you should be killed. No. Your disease should be cured. Then you can work in healthy life. So that is required. Retirement means to become cured from the disease activities, but to place yourself in healthy activities. That is Krishna consciousness. Go on.
Arjuna is here at Varsha grasping Krishna consciousness, following the footsteps of the Lord's previous disciples, such as the sun god Vinaswan, as mentioned here in the book. The Supreme Lord knows all his past activities, as well as those of persons who acted in Krishna consciousness in the past. Therefore, he recommends the act of the sun god, who learned this art from the Lord some millions of years before. All such students of Lord Krishna are mentioned here as past liberated persons engaged in the discharge of duties imposed by Krishna. 16. Even the intelligent are bewildered in determining what is action and what is inaction. Now I shall explain to you what action is, knowing which you shall be liberated from all sins. 17. The intricacies of action are very hard to understand. Therefore, one should know properly what action is, what forbidden action is, and what inaction is. Before, if one is serious about liberation from material bondage, one has to understand the distinction between action, inaction, and unauthorized action. One has to apply oneself to such an analysis of action, reaction, and perverted action, because it is a very difficult subject matter. To understand Krishna consciousness and action according to the mode, one has to learn one's relationship with the Supreme. One who has learned perfectly knows that every living entity is the eternal servant of the Lord, and consequently acts in Krishna consciousness. The entire Bhagavad Gita is directed towards this conclusion. Any other conclusions against this consciousness and its attendant reaction are beconned or prohibited action. To understand all this, one has to associate with authorities in Krishna consciousness and learn the secret from them. This is as good as learning from the Lord directly.
The action, inaction, and perverted action. These things are very important subject matter for understanding. The same example. It is very simple to understand. The same example. Your position, first of all, you must know what is your position. The position is, Krishna says, that all these living entities are my part and parcel. That is your position. Lord Chaitanya also says that Jive Swarupa Nitya Krishna Das. So as part and parcel, this is very easy to understand. Just like this finger is the part and parcel of your body. The hand is the part and parcel of your body. The leg is the part and parcel of your body. So we are all part and parcel of the Supreme. So what is our duty? What is the duty of this finger? Now I wish that you stand like this. The finger is standing like this. It is executing my order. If I say close, finger immediately close. So this is the duty. If I am part and parcel of Krishna, then what is my duty? My duty is to act what Krishna says, that's all. That is my action. without knowing this, whatever I do, that is perverted action. Just like in disease condition, this finger cannot act according to my order. Oh, there is some pain. If I want to make it stand like, I feel pain. Because there is disease condition. Similarly, when we do not act in Krishna consciousness, that is our disease condition of life. That is not normal condition. In normal condition, we shall be all prepared to act in Krishna consciousness. That we should know. Then our action will be right. Otherwise all inaction, not inaction, perverted action. Inaction is different. Inaction means what you do, there is no reaction. That is inaction. Yes, go on.
One of these inaction, and action in inaction, is intelligent among men, and he is in the transcendental position, although engaged in all sorts of activities. Purport. A person acting in Krishna consciousness is naturally free from the resultant action of work. His activities are all performed for Krishna, and therefore he does not enjoy or suffer any of the effects of work.
Reaction means when you enjoy or suffer. That is called reaction. And inaction means when there is no result on your account. Just like you are working on account of the state. The state orders you to fight. So you are fighting. You are killing so many men. There is no reaction. But without state's order, if you kill one man, immediately becomes a murderer. There is reaction, immediately. This is very simple to understand. Similarly, if you act on the supreme order, there is no reaction. And if you act on your own account, there will be reaction. Own account means whatever you do, either you suffer or you enjoy. But if you want to be inactive, neither suffering nor enjoying, in a neutral state, that is required, that is Krishna consciousness. Go on.
A form means without reaction to work. The impersonal ceases fruitive activities out of fear, so that the resultant action may not be a stumbling block on the path of self-realization. Whereas the personalist knows rightly his position as the eternal servitor of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Therefore he engages himself in the activities of Krishna consciousness. Because everything is done for Krishna, he enjoys only transcendental happiness in the discharge of his service. Those who are engaged in this process are without desire for personal sense gratification. The sense of eternal servitorship, the Krishna, is one immune to all the reactionary elements of work.
That's all. Now, any question? Yes.
Can you
explain properly once again what action, inaction is, and inaction, inaction? Action, just like you are active, you are working, you all Krishna conscious devotees, you are also working, you are not sitting idly. But it is inaction. Inaction in this sense that it is not producing any reaction. It has no reaction. But others, those who are not acting in Krishna consciousness, they are also busy. But they are producing their reaction. So things which are not producing reaction, that is inaction. One who can see that I am acting in this way, there is no reaction, that is inaction. And one who sees that I am doing this, but there is reaction, that is action. So it requires little intelligence to see how it is action or inaction. Therefore it is said that one who can see action in inaction and inaction in action, he is intelligent. Any other question? From the audience? Yes, you try to understand. Try to understand the science of God philosophically, intelligently, logically. There is no question of dogma. Everything is nicely explained in Bhagavad Gita as it is. So you can try to understand. Yes? This is Krishna's picture. Yes.
I've got this concept of meditation itself, and some of the concepts you use about as far as levels of consciousness, so you use the word cosmic consciousness and God consciousness. And I was wondering how
what do you understand by cosmic consciousness? Just explain. Just try to explain what do you mean by cosmic consciousness. What is the distinction between transcendental stage and this stage?
The transcendental is pure being, pure existence, pure consciousness, pure awareness, and the other states are pure, are irrelevant.
And what is impure?
Not impure, they...
Then how you distinguish pure? What is that object of perception that is pure?
The perceiver and the object perceived would be one.
What is that object? Give me a tangible example.
In relative existence, it would be that which exists.
What is that relative? Relative means there must be something absolute. When you speak of relative, just like you are sun, relative, immediately the conception of father must be there. Otherwise, how it is relative? So, as soon as you say relative, what is the absolute? That you have no conception of the absolute. You cannot explain. You are simply, your meditation means you are simply in the relative.
You say, it's not that you are...
You are giving definition in the, just like you do not know what it is. You say simply, it is not this, that's all. But you do not know what it is. That is not concrete definition. If I say, this is not watch, this is not book, this is not light, this is not microphone, I can go on thousands of years saying this is not, this is not, this is not. But that does not mean it is this. And if you know it, immediately say it is glass, spectacle. That means you do not know it. Simply negation, this is not, this is not, this is not the realization of the Absolute. You must give concrete idea of the Absolute. That is transcendental meditation. Huh? No, you are watching, you are not realized. But we are giving concrete absolute truth, that is Krishna. That is explained in the Bhagavad Gita. How is concrete absolute? It is just like this. You are studying this article, you are simply trying to understand it. It is not this, it is not this, it is not this. But if you take it from an authorized person who knows what it is, that this is spectacle, your knowledge is immediately there. So here, the Absolute is speaking about the Absolute. So if you understand Him, Krishna, then immediately understand Absolute. Yes. No. These people are not talking, they are realized. Talking is the beginning, but there is realization. Just like when I did not come to your country, I was talking. America is like this. But now when I've come to America, I realize what is America. So talking is theoretical understanding. And when you realize, that is practical understanding. One is called jnana, other is called vijnana. So jnana and vijnana, both things are there. Theoretical and practical. You have to adopt the process. This is Krishna consciousness. You have to adopt the process. Adu sadhya, if you are inquisitive to understand, that is your first stage of faith, that is called sadhya, adu sadhya. In the beginning, your inquisitiveness, that I want to understand, that is faith. Then next stage is association of persons who know, sadhu sangha. Then initiation. Then disappearance of all misgivings. Then steady faith. Then attachment. And then ecstasy. Then realization. These are stages. So if you are anxious to know, then please come to our classes. We are discussing simply this subject matter. So you will kindly, if you kindly come, gradually you will be able to understand. It is not very difficult. All my students, they are all American boys and girls. I have not brought with me any Indian or Hindu. by their understanding, just talk with them, they will be able to explain how they are understanding. So similarly, you will be also able to understand. It is not a very difficult subject. But you must be sincere to understand. That is the only qualification required. That's all. Yes. Yes.
By study, what is the realization?
Study? Yes. Study, simple study will not help you. You must study from a bona fide teacher. Otherwise it will be misleading. Just like if you want to be a medical practitioner, if you purchase books from the bookstore, medical books, and you study, that will not help you. You have to admit yourself in a medical college and study there, then you will understand. If you say that I have studied all the medical books, the government will not recognize you as a medical practitioner. When he will see, and the government will see, or any person will see that you have regularly passed medical examination from authorities, then you will be accepted.